Our guest tonight is Preston Dennett. Schoolyard UFO Encounters, 100 True Accounts, Blue Giant Books. Preston Dennett, I'm going to spell that out there. Preston, P-R-E-S-T-O-N, Dennett, D-E-N-N-E-T-T, dot Webley, D, that's W-E-E-B-L-Y, dot com. Well, Preston, oh, you left off with the teacher screaming. But that's not the only teacher that screamed in this particular book. But tell us about this one, or that one.
Yeah, these six kids are staring at this ET. A cow has just dropped, and this ET is trying to get back into a ship, apparently, when behind them, Miss Ohlendorf is freaking out. She's hysterical. She drags them all back into the school. She's like, you have to go inside now. And shit, they actually clears out the whole playground, which in turn had the effect of alerting to these other students to this object that was outside, which they could now see. So they're all forced back inside, and they, of course, rush to the windows. They had those old-fashioned blinds which sort of blocked the entire window, and the teacher starts pulling these down as fast as she can. And the students, of course, have rushed to the windows, and they're looking at this object, which they can still see landed there just barely through the trees, blinking on and off. They can't see the humanoid at this point. The teacher calls the principal, calls the other teachers. They cut the school day short. They close it down, send all the students to the gymnasium, get the school buses, and the students are still trying to see if that UFO is still out there, because there are a few windows in the gymnasium, but they're high up. And suddenly one of the students shouts out that he sees it, and it's darting away. And they were sent home. The teachers refused to talk about it following the incident. They pretended like it never happened.
And where was this again?
This was in St. Louis, Missouri at Point Elementary School, March 1966.
Oh, good old St. Louis. Well, geez, a whiz. Well, what's the weirdest case? I'd like to get to some weird cases, if you don't mind.
Yeah, you know, I have to tell you, there are some unusual cases, like what happened on April 29th, 1964, which this was, near Albuquerque, New Mexico at Lowell Elementary School. Now, mind you, this is like 3-4 days after the Socorro, New Mexico landing, when this student, Sharon Stull, and her younger sister, Robin, and a bunch of other students are out on the playground and see this egg-shaped object, very similarly described to what Lonnie Zamora saw. She didn't describe any symbol or anything like that, but it was an egg-shaped object, and it was pretty high up there at first, but came down low and started doing this weird bobbing motion and unusual motions. Started to get really close, scared the younger sister off, but came fairly close to Robin, who was just staring at this thing for, you know, a good 15 minutes, when suddenly it takes off. And you'd think the encounter was over at this point, but what happened was this weird physiological reaction. She started to feel quite unwell in class, you know, just hours later. Goes to the nurse, because her face is hurting like it's been burned. And the nurse is shocked. Her face has been burned. You know, there's what appear to be second-degree burns there on her face, which is what she was diagnosed with. The doctors were very puzzled. It could not have been sunburn. Her eyes were all swollen up. She couldn't read well for, you know, a long time. She had to wear dark glasses and really felt unwell for some time. And what's very interesting, it was like in the 3 weeks following this incident, she had this incredible growth spurt. She grew like a foot. And not only that, she became much more mature. It was sort of this accelerated growth, maturity almost, which really freaked out her parents, to say the least. So I don't know. It's a strange case. But there are other really weird cases.
Give me another.
There was a case from Falls Elementary School in Green Valley, California.
A lot of these are in California, aren't there?
There's a number of them, but I found them all across the United States, sure, all across the world. Just some of my my favorite, I guess, huh?
Yeah.
This is a weird case from California. This was in the mid-1970s. And this witness, who's anonymous, reported this to MUFON, I believe, about how there was this grove of trees behind the school where these objects would land and grays would come out. And this went on for years, starting kindergarten all the way up to like fourth grade, she says. And people would be on the playground and these things would come out of the grove of trees and would sit down with the students. And she says it happened to her, and there was this, you know, sort of a screen memory of a normal looking student, which she could sometimes see through and see what she now knows to be a gray, and would talk sort of mathematics and other things that were sort of over her head. It tried to convince her a couple of times to go with her. She always refused. And at some point there was an incident. She doesn't remember quite what happened, but they had to close it off. The school was eventually torn down. She, you know, went to investigate this. Because it's an unusual case where, you know, these apparently humanoids are visiting firsthand. So that's, you know, mm-hmm. not unheard of, but still sort of on the lesser end of the spectrum there.
Has anybody been abducted while at school?
Yeah. You know, we still have questions about the Rua Zimbabwe case, which we haven't talked about.
Well, let's talk about it now.
Yeah, the Rua Zimbabwe case is probably the ultimate case of this kind of schoolyard UFO encounters. And this was in 1994, September, I believe. And it was during a wave of sightings. People had been seeing UFOs in the area. That turns up in these cases. But this is certainly the most widely viewed. I think these sort of outlying cases are almost like sort of reconnaissance, perhaps. but at any rate, because we do see that sightings before, immediately before these schoolyard incidents. This object lands behind Ariel Elementary School. There's 200 students on the playground. It's a fairly large playground. So children are spread out, and at least 60 children saw this object. There were multiple objects, some up still in the sky. And these beings came out, short beings again, wearing dark jumpsuits with large eyes. One was described as having hair, by the way, long sort of black hair, looking almost like a hippie.
Yeah, I was surprised at that one. Yeah.
Right? Yeah. So, I mean, they've talked to the students immediately after this happened. There was one teacher on the playground. By coincidence, I don't know, but at that time, all the teachers were having a supervisory meeting. So the only teacher on the playground was sort of mining the snack bar, or manning the snack bar there. And was sort of at the front of the school and couldn't see what was going on. One student did run up to her and said, "There's something landed on the playground," and she didn't believe him. And a bunch of other students ran to the inside the school and said, "Something's landed next to the playground," and the teachers didn't believe them and basically said, "We're busy. We'll get to you after, you know, give us a minute." And so this incident wasn't super long. We're not exactly sure how long it was, because there was a number of students who were there who said, "Oh, yeah, I got this feeling of timelessness. It was things moving in slow motion," as these beings came forth and stood next to them face to face. There was no fence on this playground. It was just sort of a cut eucalyptus trees, logs laying down. And so they were literally just feet away, and some started to get messages. It was just a handful of students who report this, but certainly enough, because they all got basically the same message. One student said she got all these images. It wasn't words, it was more images. And the message was that we had become far too technological, and there's a good way to use technology and a bad way, and we could do much better. Another had showed pictures of forests burning and pollution and said that, you know, basically that would be the end of humanity if we didn't change. Another was warned about pollution, these types of things. So all basically environmental messages, which is interesting because, you know, this is 1994, and certainly climate change wasn't a huge talking point in Rua, Zimbabwe, at the Ariel Elementary School at that time.
Yeah.
So this is kind of coming out of left field, certainly for the children. Some of who didn't recognize these as UFOs and aliens, but most were like, "No, you know, I don't know. Could have been, you know, it was a strange figure that wasn't human," is basically what they said. And the teachers were, of course, stunned when the children were, you know, by this point crying and they're not varying from their stories. And yeah, those drawings, Dr. Bob, are moving when you look at these, and they're all trying to portray what they saw. And you see these incredible similarities. So it's an amazing case. And I think there's some question here of, you know, the time, because some of the students aren't sure, you know, how long this lasted. Did they get abducted? I don't think so. But I know a 1962 case, which is very similar to that one I told you earlier, where grays came into a school, a classroom. This is in 1962 in Conard High School in Hartford, Connecticut. And a high school student was in band practice and was going to change his uniform. He was in there with a bunch of other students when suddenly he thought his best friend socked him in the face. And he woke up and everyone's standing around him and he's trying to get up. And he's like, "Why did you hit me in the face?" And his friend is like, "What are you talking about?" And another student screams out. She's like, "Oh my God, it's, you know, half an hour later than I thought." And he started to have memories of, this was a screen memory, it turned out. Over a period of time, he started to have memories of grays coming in through the wall, stopping time, walking up to him, striking him in the forehead with this wand, and he passes out. And the grays are gone, and time starts up again. So something happened there for sure. He's pretty sure there was about a half an hour of missing time. He would later have more encounters, which, by the way, did occur in Rua, Zimbabwe. Some of these students went away from their experience of, you know, coming face-to-face with an ET and later had what we would term to be abduction by gray-type ETs.
Those messages that they were receiving, sometimes, as you note, they said something like, something is going to happen to the Earth, and that's... also, pollution mustn't be continued. Humans are not taking care of the planet. We're destroying the planet. It's obvious. Yeah. Of course, we have an administration now, in the White House, that doesn't pay a damn bit of attention to our destruction of our planet. And so that... is extremely unfortunate for this particular time, especially for younger people. So I really appreciated that particular area when you got into these messages, because, as you know, especially in the 50s and the 40s, especially in out in California, somewhere in the desert, people were getting messages and being told these same kind of things, but they were as grown-ups, not as children. That's what really affected me a great deal. Now, I understand the majority of the cases, is it the majority of the cases occur in the United States? Is that true?
Yes, that's true.
Why do you think that is?
You know, I couldn't say. I think it's probably just because of the way this is sort of rolled out publicity-wise.
Yeah.
I think these cases are being recorded and published, and there's sort of a civilian UFO movement that's pretty strong here in the United States that perhaps is not as open in other countries. I don't want to say that, but because we have cases literally from Mexico, from Venezuela, from Brazil, from South Africa, from Australia, numerous cases from New Zealand. Oh my gosh, there's a case in New Zealand we have to talk about.
Let's go to it now. Let's go. Oh, nope, time out. We got a time out on the playing field here. We're going to take a break, and when we come back, and let's get to that point. Will you do that for us?
I'd love to.
Okay, Preston, we'll do that. The book is Schoolyard, UFO Encounters, 100 True Accounts, Blue Giant Books, Preston Dennett. You should get a copy of this book. It's the only one I've ever read in this particular area that is any good. We'll be right back.
This is Kevin Randall, author of Conspiracy of Silence, Project Moondust. You are listening to 21st Century Radio's Dr. Bob Hieronymus, the best show on the air.
Well, good old Kevin Randall. Remember Kevin Randall?
Oh, yeah, sure, absolutely.
Yeah, now he went LA and captain? No, he was a colonel. Was he a colonel in the Air Force? And then he became, got his PhD. After he got his PhD, he was ridiculed by other UFO researchers because he got a PhD. I couldn't understand that. We were about ready to talk about the case in New Zealand. New Zealand has always fascinated me. We have some dear friends over there, especially those who created the Lord of the Rings. One of the things I learned before we get into this was that now New Zealand supposedly is a continent, that most of it is beneath the water. That's what I've just learned not too long ago. Have you heard anything about that?
That's fascinating. Yeah, no, I haven't.
It has been reclassified as the eighth continent. Jeez, a whiz. Whoa. All right. Now, what happened in New Zealand?
Yeah, great case. May 17th, 1970. And here we have probably one of the most widely viewed of all of these types of cases. What's really interesting in these widely viewed cases, like the Westall case, there was an airport like 2 miles away. Same with the Crestview Elementary case in Opa-locka, Florida. And that's what's going on in this case here in Maranui, New Zealand. There's 400 students out on the playground, May 17th, 1970, at Richmond School. And suddenly the teachers, they just don't hear the students. They're not playing. They're completely silent. And they look down at the students, and the students aren't playing. They're looking up at the sky. And off to the horizon a little bit, and something is approaching, is what looks kind of like a black hole or something. It was weird. It was kind of transmogrifying, changing shape. Looked like a dark object. And as it got closer and closer, they could see that it was very low and very large and took up about a third of the sky. It was extremely apparent. They all stared at it completely open-mouthed for a good number of minutes. And the teachers described it as, you know, metallic-looking, glistening, saucer-shaped, completely silent. One of the students runs up to, you know, one of the teachers there, Mr. Coveney, and said, "Is this a UFO?" And the teacher's like, "Yes, it's a UFO." And this thing kind of stood there for just long enough for people to get a really good look at it, rose up and turned sideways and basically go straight up. So what is going on here? I mean, there's got to be some reason these UFOs are doing this. And this is a really good example of this type of case. 400 students, I mean.
Yeah, that's considerable, to say the least. And I have such respect for that country. It is getting rid of all guns. It's one of the first countries in the world doing that. We should have done something about it, but we don't have the presidency that will do that yet. So I have a great deal of respect for them in lots of different ways. What do the kids say about all of this? You know, this has been going on for decades. So what do they think about all of this?
Well, as I mentioned, none have recanted their stories. Many say that, you know, later on, years later when they're interviewed, say that this is something they think about daily. It has affected them profoundly. Some have, you know, become active UFO researchers. There was one guy who saw UFOs at Bankery Primary School in Scotland. And it was just this sort of silver object, I believe, or I'd have to look it up exactly what they saw, but it was obviously not a balloon or anything, and it's gone suddenly, and it inspired him eventually to investigate UFOs, and he became one of the leading investigators of UFOs in the entire area of Scotland. He wrote Scotland UFOs. So it affects people profoundly. They become like astrophysicists, environmentalists. They talk about what happened to them in some cases. I think that they all talk, you know, about how it definitely convinced them of this object because there were other people there, which always helps.
Well, how do you think this has affected the kids?
I think what it's done is given a universal belief in UFOs. And some of these students, well, they come away from this experience, you know, with visitations. That's what happened in a really interesting case from Leonard Stringfield.
Oh my God. Oh, yes.
This is like 1975, I believe it was. And this is in Atlanta, Georgia, when this just completely frantic father calls up Leonard Stringfield and said, "My son is missing." And Leonard Stringfield, you know, he's a UFO researcher, and points this out to the father. And the father explains that, yeah, he's called the police. His son is missing because the day before, his son had been at school doing a benefit and was followed home by a UFO, the son said. But the parents didn't believe him. He's like, no, it's true. It's going to take me. I think they're going to take me. And his parents didn't believe him. So what happened was this kid drew like $500 from the bank and took off. He's a high school student. Left a really loving note saying, you know, I'll come back when I can, but I have to go. I love you. And the police found him, actually, at the airport, Atlanta airport, took him home. They called Leonard Stringfield again, and who got the whole story. And basically, as it turned out, 1 year earlier, this kid was on the playground with other students, and this UFO showed up, and he had a telepathic connection with it and felt it was watching him. And that evening, when he came home, in his bedroom, he had a visitation by short, you know, large-eyed beings, what we hear always. And they said, "Don't be afraid. We really need you to come with us," basically. And scared the living daylights out of him. And he lived with that for, you know, a year. His parents didn't believe him. Poor guy.
Well, that's the sad part of all of this, is it's the parents don't believe them most of the time. The teachers don't believe them. The children know what they saw. And they realize that they are being forced to either shut up about it or lie. That is a very bad thing to teach children.
Yeah, but some of these parents get their comeuppance, like summer of 1952 at Elder Park Elementary School. Great case, Glasgow, Scotland. All the school has just been let out. So there's a lot of people out there walking across the playground. I don't think it's a coincidence when suddenly this big round shadow starts playing over the playground. Everyone stops, they freeze. The main witness, Joan Torrance, was like, time seemed to stop. And there's this huge sombrero-shaped object that moved and stopped right over the school, 100 feet up, slowly rotating, metallic, silent except for a low buzzing noise, and stood there for, you know, they're not sure how long, 5 minutes, and took off over Glasgow. The students ran home. They told their parents. A bunch of them weren't believed until the paper came out the next day and said that, yeah, many people across Glasgow had actually seen this object.
Mm-hmm.
So the children got, you know, revenge in that one. But, you know, other cases, there's one of my favorite cases. The first case that I could find sort of in the modern era was March 1950 in Prestonburg, Kentucky. There was 35 students and a teacher, Miss Holbrook, who saw these objects. First it was just two, come swooping down literally over the playground, scaring the living daylights out of the poor students, who ran screaming in all directions. A couple fainted or became sick and thought it was the end of the world. Teacher saw the whole thing. Finally, you know, the UFOs were gone. Students recollected, you know, themselves, went back into the school. When they heard the UFOs coming back, and this time there was four of them, everyone ran outside and they saw these things. They came much closer. They could see they were metallic objects. They could, you know, with humanoids apparently. And these objects sort of came right over the school, meandered very slowly, and then took off really fast. Another obvious display. Sort of the first one that marked this whole phenomena.
Well, one of them, the stories impressed me, was one on May 17th. 1956, all of the students at Washington School in Ada, Oklahoma, this person, Kent Meyer, age 12, decided to pray to see a metallic craft. What happened?
Yeah, he was just interested in UFOs and sort of thought about it and sort of did an experiment with it, which turns out, you know, to be effective. These beings are telepathic. I don't think that's a coincidence what happened there, because you see that in a number of these cases, these weird sort of things that draw people's attention. And he saw these objects, a fleet of them. There was like triangular-shaped objects, groups of them. And he called it out to his friend, who managed to see them as well, and somehow no one else saw these things. which I have to tell you does turn up in these cases, and it's very frustrating for the students who are surrounded by kids and no one else saw this stuff because it was just meant for them, I'm thinking, in these cases.
Well, but a lot. Yeah, that, excuse me, I'm sorry.
That's a great case.
Well, there are a number of cases in which the way debunkers used to work, because I don't know if there are any debunkers left anymore. They're kind of wasting their time if they are out there debunking these things. And it's unfortunate that debunking has left marks on not just the people that have watched their life go down the drain when they see something like that, just because they saw something and the government tells them they couldn't have seen it. Many of them have lost their jobs, whose lives get threatened one way or the other. And that's one of the reasons why I'm ecstatic now that people can talk about this and there's no reason for anyone to be threatened by it, by the government. Remember the way it was in the late 50s, 60s, 70s? People's reputation, and you said this kind of thing, your reputation would be shot. They could come at you and lose your job, make you lose your job, and that kind of thing, wherever you work, and made you look like you, well, from then on, you were just considered to be one of those individuals that needs to see a psychiatrist or something along those lines. And
right.
That's why I'm so glad these things have happened, especially when New York Times broke that story a couple of years ago. New York Times has always been absolutely anti-UFOs. They were one of the last in the media. But when they got hold of the right type of information, I'm glad that they changed rapidly because it's one of the greatest newspapers on the planet, not just in the United States.
Yeah.
The thing I also wanted to note is that most of the UFOs that people were seeing during this time period were spherical or round, but very few triangles. Isn't that right?
There are all different shapes. It's kind of confounding, I have to tell you. I looked into that. There was sort of lights, globes, many classic saucers with portholes. That was not uncommon.
Mm-hmm.
But not a whole lot of triangle cases. But there were some. That high school case we just covered. Those were triangular craft, if I recall correctly.
But that's
very strange.
It's a bit different now in our culture today. Mainly, that most of the reports are. Many of them are triangular. There are fewer circular ones. I always like the circular ones. The ones I put in the murals at Johns Hopkins University and other places because I wanted people to know that at Johns Hopkins that the UFOs did indeed exist. And I don't think we get any problems with the university at that particular of this particular time in that area. But before, holy cow, you lose your reputation right away with that. There was you did the New Zealand one, Richmond School in New Zealand with the 400 students. On October 7, 1970, the Foxcroft Boarding School in Middleburg, Virginia, Jessica and about 50 other girls had an experience that some of them found to be spiritually awakening and also had a positive effect that changed their lives. Can you talk to us about this, please?
Yeah, 50 students out there studying at a very nice school, by the way, for well-to-do students. And this craft, which I do believe was triangular, came very low. It was just above treetop level and shines down this huge beam of light. And they just had a wonderful reaction to it. They thought it was the greatest thing ever in the show. They're like, wait for us, take us with you. Because this thing moved slowly enough where they could run with it for a short time there until it sort of moved off and then darted away. But overall, yeah, a very positive encounter.
Right now we are encountering another break. Isn't that true, Dr. Courtner? We are indeed. And not our final break, though. Yes, it is. It is our final break. Oh, yes. With our guest, this hour's 2 hours has gone so fast. Our guest, of course, is Preston Dennett. The book that you really need to get your hands on is Schoolyard UFO Encounters, 100 True Accounts, Blue Giant Books. We'll be back in just a few minutes. Do you appreciate the Statue of Liberty as an American goddess? Well, we do in our new book, Secret Life of Lady Liberty, Goddess in the New World. It's been described as a long overdue feminist and multi-ethnic history of the Statue of Liberty that surprisingly draws our country's entire history through this iconic image. Appreciating the Statue of Liberty as America's goddess allowed us to explore her Native American and feminist roots and to envision a sustainable future where liberty indeed prevails. What can the Statue of Liberty teach us about women's power? We'll find out at www.secretlifeofladyliberty.com. That's secretlifeofladyliberty.com.
This is Leo Sprinkle speaking. I'm a counseling psychologist in Laramie, Wyoming, interested in UFO research and reincarnation research. You're listening to 21st Century Radio with Dr. Bob Hieronymus.
Leo Sprinkle, one of the greats. It is so sad to see some of the great UFOs, researchers. That I don't hear much about, even though they're still alive, and others that have passed on. By the way, I'm telling you that this is perhaps one of the most important books you could ever get. Preston Dennett wrote it. Schoolyard UFO Encounters, 100 True Accounts, Blue Giant Books. Preston Dennett, all links are posted are at our 21stcenturyradio.com if you want to get this information. And please subscribe to our iTunes and YouTube channels for 21st Century Radio. We're about the only show in the country now that you can listen to these archives for free. Preston, tell us about the strange building Duncan Falls Elementary School in October 1966, page 148.
Yeah, I do remember this case.
Strange.
It involves a witness who, is an older gentleman who doesn't sleep a whole bunch and was taking a morning jog as he often does and sees what he first thinks is an old shed or something. Like, I don't remember that being there, and it's impossible because it's been put up, in an area where it couldn't be, right next to a school. This was actually one of the cases that John Keel brought up to say, you guys, I'm getting a lot of schoolyard UFO cases, which happened, James and Lorenzen, Coral Lorenzen.
Oh, yeah.
Made that same warning literally 2 weeks before the Westall case, as did Ray Fowler, I've got a case about him too.
Wow.
That we got to talk about. But yeah, this case is very interesting because he has a very uneasy feeling. There's no windows. It's not a shed. He knows it. He just doesn't want to admit it and runs off because he's getting, feelings of danger at this point and goes back and it's gone. It's not there anymore. It's clearly a UFO which had landed right next to the school. Which I'm telling you, they keep doing. It's incredible.
It is incredible because whether or not it seems that most people, even if they see them, don't see them.
Yeah. I mean, here's a good example in a way. This is the case I wanted to talk about from Ray Fowler.
Oh, yes. Go ahead.
This was on April 22nd, 1966, during this huge, wave of sightings over schools. And he said he had about 20 cases during this time, and 8 of them were over schools. And this is certainly one of them, Beverly High School. It's an incredible case. This starts when this young girl at night sees a UFO floating down the road right next to her window. She's on the second story. She thinks it's a car until she looks at it, and there's no windows. It's got colored lights on it. It's totally silent. It's a saucer, and it's heading towards the school. So she runs downstairs, tells her parents, there's a UFO. They don't believe her, but she insists. And they rush outside. They don't see it. Well, so three of the people there, her mother and her two friends, three ladies, decide they're going to go check it out because the girl's not shutting up. And they walk over to the high school, which is less than a block away. They live right next to it. There's a high school basketball game going on at the time, but it's inside. And they go up to the field behind the school, and there are three UFOs hovering over the school at very low level. And one of them's quite close. And one of the ladies, Brenda, she reaches up and waves her hand at it. Well, it drops down out of the sky right over their heads, 20 feet. The two other women turn and run and scream. She's rooted to the spot. And the two friends turn around, see her, you know, screaming. This object is getting lower and lower. She eventually runs away. All three of them run back home, right? Call more witnesses. They bring everyone in the house and the neighbors out. And so they've got a group of 10 people now, the daughter included, back to this field. And the objects are still there. One is now 40 feet over the school, directly over the high school. And they call the police. The police come, and like, who called for the plane? And they pointed to this object, and the police are visibly shaken. They pop out of their cruiser. They're staring at this thing. They gave descriptions to Ray Fowler later, who did find landing traces in this area, by the way, from an object. Could be this one. We don't know. But this object takes off, and what it does, it goes straight to another school 3 miles away. 1 minute later, about, it dives down and touches this other school right over this college, scares the living daylights out of these students, takes off and goes straight up. Of course, the Air Force is called in. Project Blue Book didn't do much of an investigation because their conclusion was Venus.
Excuse me, I'm sorry. That Venus was used a lot as a UFO.
Yeah, mind you, one of those poor witnesses, one of the ladies, she actually urinated herself. This object came down so low, frightened the, you know, the daylights out of her.
Sure.
That was not Venus. You know, come on. That is, you know, not only obviously false, but insulting. And a very bad way to handle, you know, an obviously volatile situation. So I'm pretty disappointed with the Air Force response to this.
Well, a lot of people, you're right, a lot of other people have been disappointed with them for such a long time. And I bet you they're a lot happier now that they don't have to go through this anymore because the word's out. By the way, have there been a school that was visited more than once?
Not really. What we're seeing is like in the, let's see, the Crestview Elementary School case, they saw it the day before. A group of six students and a teacher saw this object hovering over the school. And then it was the next day that they came. Everyone saw it. They landed. And then the following day, they came again. So we do see that sort of thing on a day-by-day basis. But in terms of one school being targeted and years later being visited, no, we don't really see that. It'll bounce from school to school, like after Beverly High School, jumps over to Gordon College like 3 minutes later. And then a week later, you'll have another sighting. It's just very interesting. Every year has a bunch of quality sightings, and it seems to be very carefully placed in a way to cause, you know, achieve their agenda, I guess. I don't know.
Well, what do
There's some pattern to it.
What do you think the agenda is?
Ultimately, I think it's getting, they're trying to get a message across, certainly in the Rua Zimbabwe case. And that message, by the way, of environmentalism is the number one message you hear in pretty much all cases, regardless of ETs. Certainly in my own research, and I think it's borne out in others. And I don't care if you're talking about, you know, the contact era from the 1950s or human-looking ETs now or praying mantis. There are cases, you know, involving reptilian as well, where they give a dietary advice and do healings, and they're very positive cases. I think this shows a positive side to their agenda. I think in some of these cases, they're, you know, particularly where children are having closer contact, they're trying to influence society in some regard, put these ideas into circulation. Like a student will have a sighting and then becomes a quantum physicist or very interested in that sort of thing, which is what happened to that band student I told you about who had missing time at a high school in Hartford, Connecticut, I believe it was. So there's that, you know, some of these students become UFO researchers, and probably not a coincidence. They're trying to get the sort of word out about this and influence society in some way and wake us up a little bit.
There's one case that I enjoyed a fair amount, and that was one on May 12th, 1979. Two anonymous students in, it looks like, Hainaut, Belgium, were given a tour of the solar system. you got to tell us about this. I mean, to have a tour through our solar system for free for a group of aliens who didn't assault them in any kind of way, what do you think is going on here?
Yeah, you know, I wish we knew more about that case, because all I was able to find actually was a sort of a brief reference to it. And I had to include it because they were walking on their way to school and saw this object and they're like, what is it? And it lands right in front of the school and they're invited on board. It was a very positive encounter. And they said, yeah, they got a tour, which is, I have to tell you, not unique. I've heard this sort of thing before.
Yes, that's right. As a matter of fact, some of the earlier ones, UFO sightings back in the 50s, few people were allegedly taking on tours. I'm sorry, but just wanted to point that out, that it used to be a very popular thing to do.
Yeah.
How come they didn't give you a tour?
Right?
Well, you've been a great help to them. You've been a great help to our country, to our planet, in introducing this material, because we shouldn't be afraid of it. We shouldn't ignore it. We don't know enough about this whole situation to make a difference, but it is a learning experience, and children seem to be able to roll with it better than adults. Do you think, is that an exaggeration?
Yeah, though I have to say in some cases, you know, adults are okay with it, or as okay as they can be. There's one kind of interesting case, which is one of the more recent humanoid cases that I could find, April 30th, 1998. This is at Attakuram Primary School in Sri Lanka. And what happened was there was this elementary school, and there were a couple of students who would come to the school first and open up because they were such, you know, well-trusted, studious students who were doing very well and in line for a scholarship and so on. And one of these students had just opened up the class and heard this very loud thump, and goes running outside and can't believe his eyes. There is a flying saucer landed on the playground at the close end. No, not, you know, next to the school. We're talking on the playground, right in front of the school classroom where he actually attended. And he said it maybe stayed there 1 second and took off very quickly, almost like it disappeared, and right back up into the sky. And he knows he didn't imagine it, because there was another student who also heard the thump and came running and saw the same thing. And what's very interesting is this, you know, these two students were obviously not lying. There was landing traces. Other students started to arrive. They saw the landing traces. The teachers saw them. They were very impressed. The principal saw them. They took pictures eventually. By this time, they were pretty much mostly destroyed, but they got some of it right. And everyone believed these students. They never wavered from their story. And one of the reasons was all the other students had seen what they called the stork, koka in their language, Sri Lankan.
Yes.
They called it a stork, which was, you know, this object that kept flying back and forth over the school. They'd seen it many times, and they tried to tell the adults about them. So now the adults believe, because this occurred at a time when several other adults had had very close encounters where it's, you know, chasing them down the road type of thing.
Well,
so
they're chasing us.
Case.
They're chasing us down the road right about now. That you even had a story one on there, some little green men. But we won't have a chance to talk about that. But I was surprised by that. And there's been a couple of cases of little green men and UFOs, which I didn't know about. Wow. Good job, Preston. I'm so glad that you're there pulling this stuff together because nobody else was. You take on some really hard tasks, and I do appreciate the quality of your research. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Preston Dennett, Schoolyard UFO Encounters, 100 True Accounts, Blue Giant Books. All links posted on 21stCenturyRadio.com. See you next week.
Talk and breaking news on Talk Radio 680 WCBM, Baltimore, and WCBM.com.
Moving forward, I'm Richard.